It goes without saying that the growing sustainability ambitions will influence the composition of investment portfolios from pension funds. Sustainability and ESG information directly feeds into investment decisions by pension funds. My name is Gerben de Zwart, and in the next 30 minutes, I would like to give you a Dutch perspective on sustainable and responsible investing. I work for APG Asset Management, and we invest our assets on behalf of the civil servants pension fund, ABP, and three other pension funds in the Netherlands. We manage about 600 billion in a sustainable way, so we do have some experience. The aim of this presentation is very clear. Today, I would like to inspire you to ingrain sustainability and ESG in your teaching and in your research by the next generation of schoolers and students. So a brief introduction of APG and his history and the overview. So four statistics. At this moment, we have 4.5 million participants in our pension plans. That's more than 25% of the Dutch citizens in the Netherlands. Our assets under management are about 600 billion, and we have been rewarded an award winning for our long-term responsible investments. In total, we have about 3,000 employees, and about 600 are working in the investment department and making investment decisions. We started about 100 years ago as the pension fund ABP in 1922. In 1996, the pension fund was privatized. And in 2008, there was a split between the asset management activities and the ABP pension funds due to regulatory reforms. At this moment, APG Asset Management is owned by its largest two clients. So we are not for profit. So the civil service pension fund, ABP, holds 92% of our assets, our shares, and the building and construction pension fund, 8%. So this gives a very strong alignment between the investment portfolios and our owners. So let's take a step back and look at the landscape of sustainable and responsible investing. It's my observation that pension funds are increasingly integrating ESG in their investments. First observation is that a growing number of asset owners, pension funds in the US, in Asia, in Europe, are taking steps to integrate sustainability and responsible investing into their investment portfolios. At the same time, the early adopters have a more comprehensive integration in their investments. Basically, they're stepping up in their ESG and responsible profile of their investment portfolios. So it's very clear that there are different maturity levels across different regions. In my perspective, European is leading with the Scandinavian pension funds, with the Netherlands. But there is also a clear trend of catching up in the US, in Asia, i.e. responsible and sustainable investing is on the rise. And I think this is not a trend, this is here to stay. Interestingly, responsible and sustainable investing, or ESG investing, doesn't have a universal definition. So it's multidimensional. So it incorporates voting at shareholder meeting. It incorporates exclusion policy, so divesting for specific companies or specific industries. It incorporates investments that contribute to the sustainable development goals. And it also involves climate risk, just to name a few. So ESG is not uniquely defined, and it has multiple dimensions. And thirdly, there is a very low correlation between the ESG ratings from different data vendors. If you combine that with a limited data availability on ESG, we have a very interesting challenge, both for portfolio managers, but also from a research and teaching perspective. Today, I would like to shed some light on responsible and sustainable investing from our Dutch perspective, and specifically the perspective that I have from APG. So first, let's look at the why. What are the drivers of sustainable and responsible pension fund investing? I see four different drivers. So the first driver is return and risk. So from a risk perspective, there is definitely tail risk in climate risk or other sustainable or responsible related risks. At the same time, it could lead to new opportunities, new investment opportunities. And by being an early mover, it's easier to seize these opportunities than to being the last. And more about risk and return on the next slide. The second motivation could be regulation. So if I look at the legislation and the regulatory landscape, I see a lot of new rules developing. It's both laws by the Dutch government. For example, it's not allowed to invest by pension funds in cluster companies that make cluster ammunition, cluster bombs. There is European regulation, like the SFDR, but there are also soft laws, like the Paris Agreement on carbon reduction. And next to that, it's the social contacts, or it's the preferences of the participants in the pension plan. So that's a little bit the next step. So it's the preferences. Individual participants, some of them have a very strong preference for more sustainable and responsible investing, but also the board members that have a big say in the investment policies, they have a strong and clear preference to make the investment portfolios even more sustainable or more responsible. In the Netherlands, we face that directly with also participants speaking up. So even protests, like the picture shows here, of groups of participants that really speak up and ask ABP or our other clients to divest from carbon, from energy investments, but also to invest more in the energy transition. So this is really something close at our heart, and that keeps us busy. And finally, there is the reputation and the peers. So for example, peer rankings are very popular. What is the greenest pension fund in the Netherlands? What is the European greenest funds or the most sustainable funds? So that's not the key driver, but it's an important driver. And also the reputation. Do we want to make an investment in a company that's not green or that really pollutes the environment of a specific area? And that's what we don't want. So these are the drivers. Let's now focus on the literature and especially the return perspective. Because many people question if a more sustainable and a more responsible approach of pension fund investments could impact or could harm the investment returns. So I quote two literature surveys, references are at the back, that do a literature survey from 2000 to 2015, and also an update from Wieland et al. From 2015 until 2020. And basically what these meta-studies conclude is that the negative impact of being more sustainable or more responsible is less than 10%. In all the other cases, the literature, and it's even 2,000 and 1,000 reports, they report or suggest a positive impact, more than 50%, a neutral or mixed impact by about 40%. So that gives that the argument that sustainable and responsible investing could harm performance is not a valid argument. And a follow-up study by Koedijk and Wetzels, it's in Dutch, but it was being performed on behalf or for ABP, shows that the literature findings are even robust across asset classes, equities, bonds, real estate, but also across the different dimensions of responsible investing, the environmental issues, social issues, and the governance. So this is an important aspect, but the literature suggests that getting a greener portfolio does not negatively impact the risk and return of an investment portfolio. So now let's focus on the targets that we have at our largest client, ABP. This is a summary of the highlights of the targets, and these are the 2025 responsible investment targets. The first target is to screen all the investments and to integrate sustainability in the full investment portfolio. So it's not a separate sleeve on having a low carbon footprint. No, it's just across the full portfolio. And it also relates to the behavior of companies. So what do we expect from companies from a governance perspective, from an environmental perspective, and from a social perspective? And then there is climate risk. What ABP wants to realize is a reduction of the carbon footprint in listed equity of 40%. And that's not against the benchmark. It's a nominal target, and the baseline is 2015. So by 2025, the carbon footprint of the listed equity portfolio should be lower, 40% lower than the 2015 footprints. Thirdly, there is a very clear target of making investments that contribute to the Sustainable Development Goals by the United Nations of 20% of the assets under management. So ABP has about 500 billion euros assets under management. It means that there is about 100 billion euros available to invest in the Sustainable Development Goals. And more about that in my presentation. On top of that, there is a last ambition, and that's to invest another 50 billion in investments that contribute to clean and affordable energy. So these four key targets, and there are a few more which are not that major as I show here, that determine our way of investing. So taking these ambitions, the key question is how APG integrates and makes sustainable and responsible investments. So to start, responsible investing is fully integrated in our investment proposition. And that's not only in listed equity, it's also in bonds, in private equity, in hedge funds, in all our investments that we make. And each individual investment is assessed on four dimensions. It's risk, it's the return expectation, it's cost, and it's ESG, or sustainable and responsible investing. This implies that responsible investing is at the heart of the investment process. And that's the diamond on the right-hand side of this slide. So it really shows and illustrates that sustainable investing is not only a nice to have, it's fully integrated in the investment process. And it also implies that data, sustainable data, responsible data, directly feeds into the investment process. And of course, we look for our ultimate investments. So that's an investment with a high return, a low risk, and that's very sustainable. That's our ideal investments. But with 600 billion assets under management, that's not always possible. So we constantly make a balance between these four dimensions. And in the end, I want to end on this slide with one of our investment beliefs. And that's that we believe that good governance and responsible investments are key to make attractive investment returns for pension funds. So what are the components that we look at in ESG for our investment portfolios? First, we look at inclusion and ESG integration. And basically, this is all about companies, how companies have their governance in place, and how they deal with the environment, social aspects, and social aspects. What we would like to do is only invest in winners. So companies that are the leaders in an ESG perspective. At the same time, there are not always leaders available. So there is an opportunity for us to engage with the company and to see if we can bring them at the leadership that we would like to have them in responsible investing. When that's not feasible or a company is behaving in such a way that we think it can never make and perform according to our ESG standards, we will not make an investment in the company. Secondly, we have engagement and voting. So Last year, we have been engaging with more than 700 companies. These engagements were about different aspects of ESG, and we have been voting in all the shareholder meetings on an annual basis, making more than 50,000 votes. Thirdly, we have the Sustainable Development Goals. More about that later. We have climate and climate risk and a climate policy, and that's fully integrated in all our investments. We have exclusion, so specific sectors, specific companies that we exclude from our investments. An example is tobacco or cluster bombs. That's excluded from our investments. And taking a step back, we collaborate with other institutional investors and we try to get and contribute to global standards and European standards related to sustainable and responsible investing. So I would like to illustrate the integrated approach, because the key message of this slide is that across the full investment portfolio, private investments, fixed income, commodities, equities, and alternatives, we have all these dimensions fully integrated. I call this stylized because in some asset classes, voting is not possible, but we will definitely engage with a general partner in private equity to also have a sustainable way of dealing with the investee companies or having sustainability targets. But this is a holistic approach. So as long as applicable, each dimension impacts all the different asset classes. And that leads to interesting questions. So what do we think from ESG policies from a high-frequency hedge fund? When you own a stock for 10 seconds, is it allowed to invest in a laggard, a company that doesn't fit to our standards? Or do we still think the return perspective is more important? Or can you short a lagging company? These are typical questions that we have and get by getting more mature in responsible and sustainable investing. So this slide is a case study on real estate. For our real estate portfolio, we have sustainability in each individual component of our investment process. And that's both the direct investments in real estate, so an individual building, an individual road for infrastructure, but also a listed equity company that we just buy on the exchange markets. What we would like to have is that all the buildings that we own have a green building certificate. Next to that, we are one of the founders of GRESB, and that's the assessment and benchmarking of real estate investments related to sustainability. And we're working with other institutions to work on decarbonization of buildings and real estate investments. And this is not only policies. On the right-hand side, you see that we use all these scores to benchmark our investment portfolios against the benchmark. And what you see is that we have an above benchmark average on the sustainability of our real estate portfolio. That's also rising over time when we look at the global perspective from 2014 up to 2020. Our portfolio has become greener. The benchmark as well, but still our investment portfolio has more sustainability buildings or high sustainability buildings than the benchmark. And we have a similar picture across all the regions. So this is not the application that you see very often, listed equity. But on purpose, I picked the real estate portfolios to show that also in this asset class, responsible and sustainable investing is feasible. So then the question about realizing the ESG ambitions. The key message over here is what gets measured gets done. So that means that only when data is available, we can measure and steer the portfolio in the way that we want. So data is a crucial catalyst for the successful implementation of sustainable and responsible investing. So the data directly feeds into investment decisions. I've mentioned that before. but also to reporting. So given all the stakeholders, I also showed you the picture of participants that really ask for divestments or greener portfolios. So transparency and reporting is very important. But also the regulator has requirements on sustainability. So for example, the Dutch regulator is asking the Dutch pension funds on the climate risk in their investment portfolios. And that leads to a data demand. So what we need is more information and better data transparency for example, climate change, the transition, physical risk, carbon emissions, but also the paths to the transition. We would love to have more data on ESG, so the environment, social, and governance. And that's not only if a company has policies in place. No, it's much more. It's also that we would like to measure real-world outcomes. So how does the environment improves, or if we make an investment in a healthcare company to save lives, how many lives are saved with investing money in a specific medicine? So we think the next maturity level is really on measuring real world outcomes. So what has been our approach for data and to get and to fulfill our data demands? Basically, it's co-creation. So to work with the mainstream data providers and making clear what's our demand for data and see if it can be delivered. At the same time, there is a big rise of alternative data providers that are able to provide us with data. And finally, there is also artificial intelligence, NLP techniques, machine learning to automate expert opinions or expert knowledge and to deploy that and to get and to extract our own ESG information. And I give you an example about the SDIs on this. So then in the end, what we will do is we will combine all these different information sources to get our own holistic perspective of the ESG profile of a specific investment. So that can be an individual listed equity company. It can be a bond issuer. It can be a private equity firm or any other of our investments. So very closely to all the accountants in the audience, it's self-reported data, company filings, company disclosures, sustainability reports, surveys, company news websites or company websites, we scrape these websites, or maybe news or public relations. So that's all self-reported data. But we blend this information with third-party sources. NGOs, governance, independent news, scientific observations, Google information, you name it, and we combine it. Finally, there is also the stakeholder intelligence, customer opinions, employee feedback on their employers, Glassdoor.com, for example, information from suppliers, and also some information from shareholders in general, or also the opinion that we have as shareholders. So by combining all these different data sources, we try to get a holistic perspective on the issues, the items that are relevant for our clients related to responsible and sustainable investing. It also means that another pension fund investor who has its own policies, its own ambitions, could use the same or similar data and get a different perspective or a different conclusion on an individual investment. And that makes it very interesting. So let's focus on the second case study, the Sustainable Development Goals from the United Nations. So basically, the United Nations in 2015 defined 17 different goals, the Sustainable Development Goals, and these goals contribute to a better world by 2030. So these investments are all about the products and services that a company delivers. So it's not about the company itself. It's about the products and services that are delivered. And we are making investments according to these goals or in line with these goals. The key question is how to measure the exposure. So which companies contribute to this? And that's shown over here. Because when we started with these investments about 5 years ago, 4 years ago, we only had the high-level definition from the United Nations. So, for example, sustainable cities and communities. And that's what we call the SDI definition. We turned that into a taxonomy. So that's a more detailed taxonomy or definitions on what products and which services contribute to the Sustainable Development Goals. In the next step, we use artificial intelligence, big data, to identify companies that produce goods and services in the field of our taxonomy. Next, that leads to a company classification. This company contributes 100% of its revenues, 50% or 0% to the Sustainable Development Goals. So that gives that we have a classification for all companies. And in that way, we can measure the exposure of the portfolio and we can also steer the portfolio in the right direction. So with this second case study, I would like to end with a few concluding remarks. So overall, what we would like to have is not only good pensions, but what we would like our beneficiaries to have is good pensions that can be enjoyed on a healthy planet. And that, I think, is a big motivation for pension funds to increasingly integrate ESG in their investments. And for a successful implementation, we need a lot of data. And that will be a catalyst, but also of crucial importance to be successful. And that data is not a nice to have. That data directly feeds into investment decisions. So the example that I showed you on the Sustainable Development Goals, we have a 20% target for the Sustainable Development Goals. So that means that the classification of companies directly impacts the investment decisions of our portfolio managers. So that's the situation today. But where is it going? From my perspective, I think that sustainable responsible investing will further accelerate. This is not something only for today or only for tomorrow. This is something that will be here to stay and it will accelerate. Next, a very interesting part is the measurement and monitoring of the impact of the sustainability and responsibility on investment return and risk. What is the impact on the real portfolio, the live portfolio, beyond the literature that I discussed today? Thirdly, measuring and monitoring the RI outcomes, as we discussed, and tracking changes over time. Increasing regulations definitely impact also the investments. The European SFDR regulation, do no harm, is also something that's coming up in the European Union. And there is also an opportunity, the emergence of new investment opportunities or investment instruments. And that brings me at the end of my talk, of my keynote talk, and I end with my key message. So what I would like to ask you is your help, because we would like to move sustainable and responsible investing to the next level. And we need sustainability ingrained in your teaching, your research, your intellectual capacity developments by you, the next generation of schoolers and students. Thank you very much.